Before church buildings, before seminaries, before denominations, before official church leadership, before Christianity, what was it like to join the nascent Christian movement? Have you ever thought about that question? But there is so much that we don't know. Even though we have all of the pages of the New Testament at our disposal, we still only catch glimpses of what the earliest Christian communities were actually like. We don't have any orders of service to tell us how they worshiped or when exactly they came together. We don't have any run-of-the-mill Sunday sermons, if in the early days they even had sermons to preach. We don't know how often they celebrated communion in the early days and what words were said over the sacrament. We don't know if the rooms were crammed with kids running around and if those early worship services were a bit chaotic because of the surroundings in ancient homes. We just don't know so much more than we know. And then suddenly, in a specific passage of Scripture, right in the middle of Philippians chapter 2, beginning in verse 6, like Indiana Jones discovering some priceless ancient relic, we hit historical pay dirt. Because right here in Philippians, we discover, still in the first generation of believers after the death and resurrection of Jesus, the earliest Christian worship song, the earliest Christian hymn that we have on record. We know, because of Philippians 2, one of the very first songs that the early Christians wrote to encapsulate their early faith. So what might you think this song would be about? Would you expect it to be the story arc of the whole Bible? Maybe it would be about Jesus as the fulfillment of the Old Testament promises? Not really. Maybe it would be about the empty tomb and Easter Sunday? Sort of, but not exactly. Maybe it would be principally about the establishment of the church? Not at all. Instead, the first Christian song summarizing what the early Christians thought was most important about Jesus and the gospel message was the relationship between Jesus and the Father. Here's what the song says, often called by scholars the Christ hymn in Philippians 2. Your attitude should be the same as that of Christ Jesus, and now the hymn begins. Who being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross, which that phrase Paul actually adds to the hymn himself. Therefore God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. This assertion about God, of course, was the earliest Christian innovation. Old Testament concepts of the coming Messiah understood him as a man especially anointed by God, like Moses or David. But when Jesus rose from the dead, those bets were off. God had shown himself not upon the anointing of a man, but in Jesus, who declared his oneness with the Father throughout his ministry. The story of God's essence does not end there, of course. In John 16, verse 7, Jesus promises to send the Counselor, the Paraclete, the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, to be with his community after Jesus' departure. And in Acts chapter 2, the coming of the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost births the New Testament church. Our mandate as the church is to introduce people to the triune God, to the Trinity. Jesus said it in his final charge to his disciples in Matthew 28, verse 19. Therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.